to the round 5 edition of the SuperCoach Edge podcast. My name's Damon, and this week our episode is brought to you by none other than COVID.
Oh,
good old COVID. As you, very, very, I can tell you firsthand, Liam, that it's not tasty. As yes, I have fallen under the AFL's health and safety protocols. So I had to get that out. Just choking on my COVID. Don't mind me. Yes, but COVID has finally caught up with me after having dodged it numerous times. But as you know, SuperCoach never sleeps, and nor do I. As I welcome in my co-host, ushering you, Liam. Welcome aboard.
Thanks, Damon. You probably should sleep with COVID. You probably should fix that. But I must admit, I wasn't sure if we were going to need to, you know, make a late change and bring in one of our top-up players from the SuperCoach Edge COVID list. But luckily not. You're soldiering through it, Damon. You're here. It's good. It's a good episode to be here. It's a very good episode to be here.
Yes, it is. We'll get into this very shortly as to why, but I wouldn't want to miss it. I wouldn't want to miss it for the world. I wouldn't want someone just to roll in like Franco Cozzo or one of the other ringins, as you said.
Oh, we could have had Franco. We've had a good episode with just Franco.
But he just would have been spruiking his bloody El Modernissimo. Like, come on, Franco. You haven't sold an item from the El Modernissimo range for about 10 years. Give it up, mate.
Hey, we got him some sales last year.
Yeah. I must be careful.
His sponsorship worked out.
That's true. As you'll see, I must be careful with using my hands because I'm just waiting for an umpire to just roll in the door, burst through Kramer style and blow the whistle like, nope, umpire descent. But I must say, Liam, that I feel a little bit like Jordan Belfort from Wolf of Wall Street, where he says,
I'm not leaving.
I'm not fucking leaving! The show goes on!
Oh, yes, the show indeed does roll on. And we have an action-packed ep to dive into, filled with discussion on some DPP additions that happened over the weekend. And we have a very, very special guest joining us over this episode.
Yes. Let's just say, Liam, that we'll give our good listeners and viewers the scoop by dropping a hint.
Mm.
But I guess that in itself is the hint. So with that, let's jump into the show.
In the good, the bad, the ugly, we run through a quick recap of how our respective teams performed and the players that stood out for both good and bad reasons. And I just had a shit one, let's be honest. 2,108 was my score. Not happy at all. Overall ranking of 20,059. Real dive in the rankings. I'm really, really actually upset. But anyway, I did make the two trades. I traded out Baldwin to Nathan O'Driscoll with some lovely DPP swings. And I did bring in Brody for Butters, as I think I alluded to in the episode last week. Now, I know it does sound like a bit of a rage trade, and let's be honest, it kind of was. But I think I felt like I needed Brody. And I did discuss this with you a bit, Damon, at length. And I think the only viable candidate for me for trading in but Brody was Butters at that stage. I just think that I actually said this to you as soon as I saw Butters score after that game, and it was, if I'd kept him, he was going to score 50. If I traded him out, he was going to, you know, crack the ton. But you know, it is what it is. I think it's not the SuperCoach season is long, and I mean, Brody made 50k on the weekend, which is just what I need. Some cash, a fattened cash cow that's scoring well. So I'm okay with it. But anyway, let's jump in the good column. I've got Jack Steele. He continued to repay the faith with a solid 131 on the weekend. Now I give my honorable mention to Jack McRae with a score of 153, just because, you know what, it's what I expect from him. So par for the course with that lovely captaincy score. So you know what, doesn't get a good mention. In the bad, I've got our boy Matty Rao. The only way is up has become the only way is down. And he has starting to bleed cash to an extent. And he dropped a little bit, but I think it's going to continue. He'll be making his way out of my side this week for an early upgrade, but we'll chat about that a bit later. And in the ugly column, I've got Brody Grundy. Very poor showing by his standards. And with that score of just 53, just frankly, not good enough. No. But I bet he's going to bounce back. He has a massive average against my Dons. And again, we'll chat about that in a later segment. Mm. What about yourself, Damon? How'd you go?
Interesting. Yeah, not too bad. I was a bit disappointed because I thought, like, heading into the, as it always is the case, heading into Sunday games, you're like, yep, I'm projected for 2,400, neck minute, rolling out of bloody Easter Monday. It was 2,192 I scored. Mm. And I ended up winning, I think it was 6 of my 10 leagues, which wasn't too bad, but there were a couple of games there where I lost literally like by, I think it was a margin of like 5 points or thereabouts, 5 to 10 points were a couple of them. And that hurt because I was projected to beat these opponents, but c'est la vie. So in terms of overall ranking, I'm ranked 5,086th overall, dropping 693 spots. So not too bad, I guess, in terms of that. I must admit, Liam, and I'm sorry to say this, but I was a bit disappointed with my score, and then I saw yours, and you've done me a bit of a favor. You've yeah. pepped me up a little bit, put a bit of a pep in my step.
I'm glad because I was... I was filthy, absolutely filthy. But anyway.
Yeah, but in terms of trade, so very much like yourself, I brought in Noddy at the expense of Hoff. So yeah, I guess it's virtually an upgrade of one stalled cash cow to one that's on the rise. So I think it kind of speaks for itself. Had other options as well, like yourself. I was thinking of potentially maybe trading out Baldwin, who is my loop option at the moment, and I'm glad that I didn't because I used him to loop in Jack Hayes' score of 105, who was my emergency on the bench up forward. But I was potentially going to swing DeConning into the forward line, and then that would have allowed me to, I guess, yeah, trade Baldwin to O'Driscoll and play him on field, which wasn't to be. But yeah. What will be, will be. In terms of the good, so McRae, yes, he takes the full honours here. I think it's pretty stiff, Liam. You only gave him the honourable mention. But no, yeah, I think I agree. It's the 153 is par for the course. But yes, doubly as good as he was my vice captaincy, which I promptly locked in. In terms of the bad, short, he's in this this column here because he had an absolute stinker, scoring just 56 points in a day where I guess Richmond's whole defensive unit struggled against the Crows. So I guess I'm not too fazed considering that, and probably more so as well considering that it is his first score under 100 for this season. So yeah, cut him some slack. So he's not in the ugly column as yet, unless he does it again next week. See that as a warning shot. But in terms of the ugly, very much like yourself, Grundy takes the cake here with 53 points in a day where he had no real excuses, I think. And the most surprising was he had zero marks and zero tackles, which is very un-Brody Grundy-like.
Yeah.
And I guess it indicates that he's not doing enough around the ground, which is kind of what he's renowned for. And especially like, you know, sharking the ball, you know, if he's not winning the hit out, he's actually there at the stoppage, sharking the ball, getting a clearance type thing. It's, yeah, it's almost like his work rate isn't up to scratch. And I don't know why. Strange, isn't it?
Well, it was interesting. I saw some stats today that kind of alluded to the fact that he is going okay, but it looks like he just sort of had a bit of an off game. He's the highest possessions for any ruckman at this stage of the season. So that's where it's interesting, is that I think he just had a game where he just, you know, as you said, he took zero marks, he had laid zero tackles. Maybe it is just an off game and it's going to bounce back. I mean, he was sort of averaging not too badly before that.
Yeah, 109.8 heading into the weekend.
Yeah, so just sort of the one bad game.
Yeah, it's probably a little bit of an overreaction, I think, because looking at his previous scores, like that score in isolation, you're like, that's putrid, what is he doing? But, I mean, he scored 124, 101, 96, and 118. So, yeah, you're totally right there. I think people can't be too reactionary, which is what people are doing. Surprise, surprise. Not so much to ourselves.
How many trades is he in?
He's in
7.5%.
7.5. Oh, 7, wow. You must have refreshed it.
7,116 people have traded him out this round so far.
Gee whiz. It's just not good enough. But people have to heed our warning. Keep hold of these primos. But anyway, we'll be here all day if we want to delve into that. So let's quickly move on, Liam, because I am hastening the chat, because let's have a look-see at our head-to-head. And you can do the honors here because I did it last week.
Yeah, of course I can. Yeah. You have won four games. I have lost four games, one for Damon, one game four, obviously, for myself, with a point differential of 201.
Yes, I've extended the lead out, but as I always say, Liam, and as the common saying goes, a week is a long time in footy, and especially in Supercoach. And given it's trading season, or upgrade season, that can turn around very quickly. So I'm not getting too ahead of myself, and very much like the Baggers, I'm 4-1, and I could very easily be 2-3. To do the maths in my head, my COVID.
Yes.
COVID brain's not working. Yes. Very much like
Carlton. In the first couple of rounds, that is true. In the first couple of rounds, there was only sort of the, I think it was 14 points that just separated us after round two. So very good, very true, very true. But I've got to maybe hopefully got something up my sleeve this week that might help tip the odds in my favour, but never know. I never know. But anyway, let's look back on what transpired across the round with the week that was. In the week that was, we keep you up to date on the key talking points of the round, and the big one this round comes in the form of the DPP changes for specific players. There are 39 players in total, which you can find on our socials and the AFL website, but here are the most notable, especially for Supercoach. Damon, do you want to kick off with mids who have gained that handy DPP?
Yes, there's a couple of juicy ones here, and from the top we have Pendlebury, who's gained defensive status. Dane Zorko, also a defensive status eligibility now. Dacos is the big one. It's going to help out a lot of people, being able to swing him into defense, I guess a D5, D6 type setup. Lipinski, he gains forward eligibility. McDonald, youngster from the Hawks, also forward eligibility. Jackson Mead from Port, forward eligibility as well for those people that have him on the bench that need some cover up forward. And Lukey Parker from the Swans, also gaining forward eligibility. What about those in defense who have gained DPP?
Yeah, we've got Jordan Dawson from Adelaide. He's now midfield eligible as well as Sinclair from the Saints. He's also midfield eligible now. And Damon, forwards, who's gained some handy DPP.
Ah, yes. One man who you're in tune with. Wouldn't melt in his mouth, this bloke, Butters. he's gained mid status. Nick Martin, young gun. Oh, young, mid, I don't know what you call him, but
21.
Yeah, so youngish. Youngish. Gets forward mid eligibility. And Tristan Cherry Zeri, X-Man, gets ruck eligibility. But yes, I mean, just to sort of summarize it, it speaks for itself, but this probably comes at a perfect time with upgrade season upon us, with DPP swings between lines and the fact it provides further cover. And like I mentioned, I mean, Dacos is probably the one out of all of those in terms of those players that a lot of coaches already have in their team that is probably the most crucial. And for myself, I guess it means I no longer have to rely on SDK or Sam DeConning to play as D6. And Martin, for me, is probably the second most crucial for mine as the midfielder forward swing, as he'll be probably sticking around in most teams, and he definitely will be in mine for a fair while, you'd think, as one of the more reliable rookies, both, I guess, in terms of scoring and in cash generation.
Mm.
What are your thoughts, Liam? Just you agree entirely?
I agree entirely. I think Dacos into defense, just it means that I can loop McCartan and O'Driscoll and sort of see who scores better. And sort of be able to play that without having to worry about, you know, playing McCartan every week or, you know, Hinge or O'Driscoll. So it's nice. It's just a bit more of a luxury to sort of fill out the team, which is nice.
Very nice. Well, that was our rapid fire explanation. If you want to see the full list, feel free to head to our Facebook page and you can see it. We've listed the full list of the 39 players. Outside of the more popular ones. Otherwise, check out the AFL website and they do have it. I think it's the traders, the AFL fantasy crew there have listed them. So check that out. But now, Liam, it's time to turn our attention to the trade front with The Price is Right.
The price is wrong, bitch.
Yes, in The Price is Right, we run through the top buy, sell, hold, and wait options for this round of SuperCoach. We'll chat about the pros and cons and what we'll be doing with our teams this week. And we've structured this segment, like last week, a little bit differently. And we'll run through players and give you our assessment for what we think you should do with them. And first up, we've got Aaron Hall, who's obviously a defender, 511.3K, averaging 98 with a break-even of 128. He's done his hammy again, and it is time to move him on. Simple sell, move him on for the likes of another primo defender. You have to put in a little bit of cash because he did drop a bit with that low score. But the likes of Doherty, Tom Stewart, Sinclair, all of those guys, just you won't go wrong just trading them off to someone that is scoring well. So definitely sell for me.
Yep, sell. Next player in line is Malcolm Rosas?
Rosas.
He is forward eligible, comes in priced at 130.6K, averaging a 73.5. And his break-even, I think it's a negative 71 or thereabouts, I think, from memory. Let's see if my memory serves correct. Negative 71. Look at that. Photographic memory.
Look at you go.
COVID hasn't really killed that part of my brain, so eat a dick, mate. I guess he comes off the bubble with scores of 74 and 73. Quite nice, quite juicy. And he could be a great downgrade option that helps build bank or, I guess, fund another trade. His scores have come in a win and a loss, so it's always good to see this consistency no matter how the team performs. His score in game one looks to be predominantly from his three goals, but his score on the weekend looks to have come from 7 tackles and 15 disposals. So, I think for me, and I think for a lot of people, he's going to be a buy because, he's promising, as I said, that he's scoring well enough without having to rely on goals. And, yeah, he passes the eye test, especially in a team like Gold Coast that is going to be up and down throughout the year.
Yeah, I agree. He'll be coming to my side as a handy downgrade option to give me some cash to upgrade this next guy, which is Matty Rao, who is mid-eligible, 401.4K, averaging 92 with a break-even of 103. His score of 64 on the weekend means he has started to lose cash, and it looks as though his role just can't justify, his scoring. Playing that run with role just isn't as conducive to SuperCoach scoring. When he does manage those, mammoth scores that we saw in, I think, round one and round three, it's when he gets that chance to hunt the footy and really be, that in and under player that just gets to win his own ball. Unfortunately, he's a sell. I'm going to be moving on this week. Yeah. I'll be upgrading him to, I don't know who yet, but someone better.
Someone juicy, yeah. Yeah, yep. You're totally right there. It pains me to say, but it's unfortunate as he is our boy and we've been threatening. It hasn't come out of the blue. Ooh. We've been saying that we've sent him through his room, giving him a slap on the wrist. And now it's, sorry, mate, we're just going to have to disown you. For the time being, he may come back in. Maybe if Gold Coast play him like how he should be instead of being a run with player. But I can easily see him returning to those big scores when his role does permit, like it did early on. But unfortunately, it is just too inconsistent at the present time. So, it may be, Liam, from one of our boys to another in terms of my boy, which kind of gives away who I'm looking at, which we'll delve into right now, Liam. Who is it?
Is Sammy Walsh.
That's it.
Who is mid-eligible, 610.4K, averaging 110.8 with a break-even of 124. Which seemed quite high for a player that you want to be trading in, but Sam Walsh looks to have settled.
Quality.
Yeah, that is true. That is true. He looks to be settled and is back to some strong scoring with a season high of 128 on the weekend. Now, Damon, you've obviously got to keep in mind that it was in a side without Cripps, who is apparently set to return this weekend. I reckon he doesn't play. Just feel like it's gone from, it's a 1 week injury to, he's a test. We've got to make sure he's okay.
No. So, we spoke about it last week.
Anyway, he has shown what he can do. Do it with him in the team when he scored 124 in round three. He is most certainly one that I am considering as an upgrade target from Matty Rao. So he is a buy, but he's also sort of a wait as well. You don't necessarily need to get him in this round. His break even is 124. So he'll probably hover it around that same price, I'd expect, with some of the scoring we've seen so far.
Yeah, it really depends on, I think, if you're as keen as mustard like me, and you know, we talk about, you know, not trading with your heart. Always trade with your head over your heart. But here my heart is, because, you know, I've been longing for him to be in my team, as he was pre-season before he injured himself. But, yeah, yes, this is the first opportunity that I'm able to train him into my team. And he's already, you got to keep in mind as well that he's already dropped 26.7K. I mean, it isn't a lot, but he comes at a slight bonus when you look at it from that perspective. And, you know, it's going to be hard to say no trading him in this week, I think, for myself. But there are a couple of other options as well that I am looking at, which we'll sort of list at the back end. But just quickly, it could be Doherty, another fellow bagger who has been killing it, really impressed and has been inspirational the way he's come back and, you know, I guess bounced back from the ailments that he had off-field with what he's had to deal with. So, you know, it looks from the outset now that he's going to be a top six defender. And there's another guy which we'll roll through as well. But let's have a chat about just quickly touching on three guys, Liam. I'll handball this one to you in terms of three guys that are on the bubble, but are ones that you should probably not really consider.
Yeah, they've got three here. First one up is Marcus Windhager. Second one is Nathan Kruger. And the third one is Tom Wilson. They're all on the bubble this weekend. Other than Windhager, who sort of is that one, I think off memory, 117K. The other two are higher priced, just under the 200K. I just don't think it's justified. I think you're probably better off looking at someone like Rosas instead. I think we've got another couple on the horizon as well in terms of Sam Hayes and Ben Hobbs from Essendon, who had a pretty tidy score considering his role. I think they're sort of players that I've been looking to rather than these three. Nathan Kruger, obviously, playing a bit more as like a key position player off memory.
Yes. Yep. Yeah, he has been. Yeah, I think he's been playing forward. Bit of utility, yeah. So he's not going to be the highest.
So it's, and I think those higher price points just make it a bit awkward. And Marcus Windhager just hasn't really shown much with scores of 33 and 43 respectively. So basically those three are you can always factor them in, but probably ones that I would be keeping lower on the list.
Yeah, absolutely. And just touching quickly on those to keep an eye on, you can probably, list good old Sammy Walsh here as well, because you're not really forced to get him this week unless you're me. Keep an eye on Doherty, like I mentioned, but also Clary Oliver, who I guess both of these guys have a subpar score in their three-round rolling average and should at least stay around their price at very least. So I guess you're not forced to trade them in this week, but there are ones to definitely target for your finalized side come the end of the season. So I guess in Oliver's case especially, he could potentially drop below 600K because his break-even is 174. So wait and assess next week, I guess this weekend. But you wouldn't be blamed for pulling the trigger on Doc, I think, of those two, who has an achievable break-even of 112. But whose break-even should stay relatively high next week, provided he doesn't absolutely trounce that break-even. So keep that in mind and keep your eye on both of those guys. Now, Liam, it is time for a returning segment, first one of its kind for season 2022, and it is...
Compare the pair.
Same price.
Same position.
Same SuperCoach contribution.
But there could be a season of difference between their scoring output.
Compare the pair. Now, Damon, that was beautiful. Who are we comparing this week?
Just first of all, you're frantically like adding to the run sheet whilst we just did it off cuff.
Yeah,
I didn't even need to rehearse it.
That was amazing. That's true. I don't know why I was worried about that.
We know who reads each line. That's a good. We shouldn't even need to read it. We just know off by heart. But the two guys that we're comparing in this episode is Braden Pruce and Sam Hayes. Very contentious, discussed topic. Let's kick it off, Liam, by just a quick discussion point on Braden Pruce.
Yes, Braden Pruce, obviously 204.7K, averaging that 105.5 with a break even of minus 91. Pruce is potentially on the bubble this week. And I say potentially because you never know with Leon Cameron and just Pruce in general. He obviously did sit out round five with that suspension. His scores in his previous two games would leave many coaches considering bringing him in as an R3. And I have seen some consider trading him in as an R2 for Brodie Grundy, which is insane. But I just don't want to. I just don't want to talk about it because I don't want. Yeah. If I like, if I talk about it, it's justifying it.
Yeah, exactly.
But anyway, so let's move on. There's a few points that I like to consider with Bruce. One is his potential to miss games through injury and suspension. He's already been suspended twice this season, and it's only round five. Mm-hmm. And he also didn't play last year just due to multiple injuries. So he's got that injury history and he's got that potential for being suspended. Don't like it. The other thing is Matt Flynn is always going to be waiting in the wings. He did have a very solid game against the Gorn-Jackson combo, with Flynn actually having the most hitouts for the game. So can he get? Does he get moved out of the team for Bruce? Do you drop him straight after that? Does he tag team with Bruce? And what effect does that even have on Bruce's scoring? I don't know. Yeah. But Damon, before we sort of have a chat about our, you know, thoughts on which one we'd be going with, do you want to chat about Sam Hayes?
Yes, Sam Hayes. So obviously Port Adelaide ruckman, sole ruckman now because they lost Lysette for quite a few, well, I think 3 months. So yeah, he's priced at 123.9. So he comes in priced, what's that, 81, yeah, nearly $81,000 cheaper than Bruce. His average is 75 and he's break even. I guess it just waits to be seen in terms of how he performs on this weekend. Yeah. So he's obviously not, like I said, the bubble boy this week. So don't really factor him into your trading plans this week just yet. But with Lysette missing the 3 months, Hayes has little competition for the number one ruck role at Port. And I guess the other point is his lower price will also mean that he doesn't really require as high scores as Bruce will to continue making money. So that's a big thing to factor in, I think.
Yeah, that's where I kind of sit. And I think this is a tough one. It's a tough compare the pair. It's a bit of a sticky situation. And I think we'll only really be able to make an educated decision once teams are released on Thursday night because I'm a little bit worried about Bruce. He does have the highest ceiling you'd expect over Hayes. But it sounds stupid, but his job security is a little bit more questionable. Not that I think he's going to get dropped, but more so just how does he factor in with Flynn? How does he factor in with the team? Does he do something stupid and get suspended again? You know, just it's all those sort of factors that come in. I'm probably going to hold off for Hayes and forgo Bruce. I think his lower price makes him more, makes me feel more comfortable with him as an R3. He's going to instantly give you sort of 80K more cash if you downgrade him to from a whoever as opposed to Braden Pruce, which gives you instant cash. But then he's also probably doesn't have to score as highly as Pruce will to continue making that money. So I'm okay with that. And I think sitting he's not going to be playing for me. He's going to be sitting on the R3 bench unless there's an injury. So I'm happy with, I'd rather sort of have that cash to be used somewhere else for me personally.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely correct. Especially on both fronts there in terms of Bruce, you know, we've discussed having the higher ceiling than Hayes. Whereas I guess what's going for Hayes is the fact that he has better job security going for him. So I think it really comes down to, you know, first of all, whether you can afford to fork out an extra 80K odd for Bruce over Hayes. And I guess one thing with Hayes that I've noticed, I'm just having a look at the stats because I love my stats, as we both do, Liam. Most concerningly, Port were really super conservative with Hayes and his ruck contest attendance percentage, which paints a bit of a picture in terms of, I guess, not so much job security, but the fact that they're being really conservative with him, taking 57% of the ruck attendances, whilst Finlayson took 20%, Marshall 14%, and surprisingly, Powell Pepper 9%. But I don't think Port can really afford to run him ragged as the sole ruck. You know, I guess he might be pinch hitting in a sense, you know, getting similar sort of numbers to a Nick Natanui potentially. I'm just looking at those numbers there. But, you know, they can't really afford to have him as the sole ruck at the expense of him potentially getting injured. And then, because I don't think they really have an alternative to Hayes at the moment. So this timeshare, I think, is something that may continue throughout the year. And you've got to also factor in the fact that it was his first real go at senior level. So, you know, they want to protect him. So maybe that's the fact, you know, as to why this happened on this weekend, being his first game. Maybe it opens up where he has 68%, 70% type CBAs or, you know, RCAs, ruck contest attendances, like Bruce is having. Because Bruce is around about getting I think he's running back 60, I'm just looking quickly, 67, 66%, and he's getting a chop out from Lachie Keefe and Jake Riccardi in both of his, both of his games, so far. Whereas Flynn on the weekend had 67% and Keefe had 33%. So no matter who plays, that looks as though that's sort of around about the mark of what Bruce is going to have. He's not going to, that's sort of a cap on his ceiling in terms of what he can do in the ruck. But yeah, it just remains to be seen. I think it's just a long roundabout way of saying it's a bit of a flip of the coin. You know, it's one of those things where price point's a big factor. Like you mentioned, Hayes isn't going to really have to average too much in order to go up more in price than what Bruce will. So, and it depends as well. If you're relying on Bruce on field, I would say go for Bruce. Sorry, if you're relying on one of these guys to play on field, go for Bruce because he's got the higher ceiling. R3, can you justify spending the extra 80K if he's just literally sitting there on you know, your bench as the R3? Yeah, it's, I don't know. And just quickly as well, in terms of buys, who covers who? So that's the other thing to factor in as well in terms of, I think Bruce, yes, Bruce will cover both Gorn and Grundy who share the same buy. So that, and so will Hayes. So there you go. So it doesn't really matter in terms of.
That shouldn't factor that in too much, yeah.
Nah. But anyway. Yeah.
What would you do, Damon? What's your, what way are you leaning?
I really hate the fact that Hayes is like, well done to him personally for making his debut, but it's really ill-timed because I had my heart set on Bruce, and I know a majority of people are going to go for Bruce because he burst on the scene first and we've seen more exposed form. And like I said before, I'm a numbers man and I love to see weight of numbers when it comes to, you know, using sort of the rolling theme with compare the pair is, you know, can past performance be a true indicator of future performance? I don't think it can, but I'm very much a numbers man. I'm leaning towards Bruce because I can't afford him because I do have that, I'm going to say dead rookie, but he's fleeting. It's Dylan Stevens from the Swans on my bench, priced at 202-300. So I can virtually do a straight swap. So that's the reason why. If I had to fork out and try and find a way to you know, fork out 80K in order to get Bruce, I would go for Hayes. So it's a bit of an each way bet there. But I'm leaning towards Bruce ever so slightly. But I don't know. What about you, Liam?
Yeah, I'm probably the opposite. I'm leaning, as you said, I'm kind of exact opposite. I'm just leaning towards Hayes. But it's mainly just because he's going to be sitting on as an R3. I'm not worried about his scoring in the sense of I don't need to worry about his scoring on my field. So if he bangs out 75s, I don't really care as long as he's making cash. And I think that 80K can be used elsewhere on my field where it might actually mean that I actually get a player who is going to affect my scoring week to week. Sort of that's where I'm sort of factoring that in. But it is really, to me, a flip of a coin. It's just such unfortunate timing that Hayes is
he's on the scene
as he is, yeah.
Yep.
But good for him. Good for him.
As we say, Liam, for us. But as we say with this,
past performance is not a reliable indicator of future performance.
Exactly. Spot on. And that is the discussion that was compare the pair. But let's move on to captaincy chat with Liam.
I'm the captain now.
Look at me.
I'm the captain now.
Yes, we've scrambled through the data and found the best options for your VC and C this weekend. And we'll give you some of our honourable mentions later in the segment. But first up, on Friday night, 7:50, first game of the round, against his old side in GWS, we've got Jack Steele, who averages 109.5 over his last four against the Giants, with scores of 91, 149, 98, and 100. Obviously, only one of those scores is sort of captaincy worthy. But I think with his sort of run of form, I mean, his scores are just increasing as the weeks progress.
Yeah, exactly right.
And as a nice little Friday night game, easy VC option, good option, I think, if you ask me.
Yep. Yeah. Against the struggling Giants as well. Obviously coming off that that thumping, I guess you could call it, against the D's. So, you know, if they're in for a bit of a shit one as well, it could really go in the favour of Jack Steele. But the next option is equally, if not more juicy, and it is Jack McRae against the Crows on Saturday at 1:45 p.m. He's averaged 136.25 over his last four against the Crows with scores of 131, 118, 119, and a 177. Whopping 177. So that's obviously inflated that overall four-game average there, but looking very, very juicy for obvious reasons. And the fact that he is in ripping nick. I think he went off at one stage on the weekend with a precautionary head knock concussion test type scenario, potentially. He came back on and scored the 153. So what a trooper.
Love it. Love it. Moving on, we've got Lockie Neal against the Suns on Sunday at 4:10. So we've gone to a much later game. Averaging 110.5 over his last four against the Suns with scores of 64, 151, 142, and 85. Yeah. Again, just not great score. I mean, two really good scores in there, 151, 142, but really dragged down by that 64 and 85. But he's just in good form. I mean, I know he only scored the 117 on the weekend, but he's averaging 137.6 for the season. So, I mean, not a bad captaincy option if you need it. So just one to factor in, I think.
Yeah, for sure. But there's another guy as well by the name of Max Gorn who is in ripping nick against Richmond on Sunday at 7:25, averaging 147.25 over his last four against the Tigers with scores of 147, 163, 145, 134. What a ripper.
You know what else is just on Max Gorn? His last two scores haven't really come from a change in his role. He's just actually taking marks. Like what we sort of, I guess, alluded to earlier in the season was that his issue wasn't necessarily the role. His issue was the fact that he just wasn't, he wasn't taking marks. He wasn't, you know, having that around the ground effect. There was actually no real change to his sort of role in the last couple of weeks, which is good to see from what I understand. So definitely one to consider for that Richmond game as your captaincy option. But last up, and it's going to come from a bit of left field, I reckon, but it's Brodie Grundy. As I mentioned, comes up against the Dons on Anzac Day, big game on Monday at 3:10. And he averages 130.25 over his last four against the Dons with scores of 153 and 83, 151 and 134. So there is a rich run of form against the Dons. And I can see him continuing that this weekend and bouncing back from his, you know, not great score of 53. Yeah. So that's the risk I see with everyone that's trading him out this round as well, is that I really think he's going to bounce back. I really do. So
he's going to do a bit of a Zachy Butters.
I think he will. I really do. Yep.
Honourable mentions, Liam?
Yeah, I've got your boy, Sammy Walsh, against Fremantle.
You have.
Scores of 124, 138, 123, and an 80 for an average of 116.5. Obviously really dragged down by that 80. Bit of a sort of, I guess he's a bit of a pod captaincy option for you. What day does he play off the top of my head? I'm not sure. Plays on
a Sunday, potentially.
Saturday, 7:40. So Saturday. Potentially could be a VC option with the sort of this elongated round yep. running from Friday to Monday. So depending if you've got a late enough loophole option, he could be someone that you can VC as well.
Yes, very nice. But seeing as though you've taken my man, Liam, one that's definitely out of the box and I don't own is definitely a pod. Baz Lenker, aka Bailey Smith, yes. who faces the Crows, and he's coming off the back of scores of 139, 80, 122, and 135, and he's having scored 105, 150, and 87 in his last few against the Crows. So this is purely a speculative selection based on form alone, but I still probably wouldn't choose him. I definitely wouldn't choose him over McRae if I had both of those players in my team. So he's more of a pod option if you've got a tendency to stray from the pack. That's one that's is a rabbit from the hat.
Very nice. Very nice. Now it's normally time for our famous I Gots to Know segment, but we've reserved this spot for our very, very special guest. So let's make him welcome.
We are now joined by a very special guest who is fresh off winning the weekly prize as the highest scoring team for round five. And a few of our audience would know him already on Facebook as the sole admin of the AFL Information Trade Rumours and Results page, and for his work on Kick It to Scoops on YouTube. Let's welcome in Cooper Grech, otherwise known as Scoops. Thanks for joining us, mate.
Thanks, Damo. Thanks, Liam, for having me on.
Thank you. Big score of the weekend?
Yeah, big score, 2,557. Started off well. I started the week, every single week, I'll go through the Thursday game, keep individually going. This barrack for my SuperCoach plays, in other words, no matter what teams are playing, when people may think I'm barracking for teams, I might be, but secretly I'm barracking for my SuperCoach players as well.
Oh, very nice, very nice. And have you ever come, I imagine this is your first time winning the weekly. Have you ever come close to winning it in the past? And I guess going back to when you first started, how long have you been playing SuperCoach?
So I've been playing it since high school. So I've been out of high school for just about 5 years now. So I've been playing it about almost 10 years or around that 10-year mark. I've been around the top 5-10% range for the last 4 years. I did have an off year last year. I could semi-blame COVID, but that was the year before as well. So I probably can't use that excuse.
I'll use that excuse. So.
That's right. I was probably top 20%, around the 20% mark last year. But every other year in the 6 year period, I've been top 5-10%. And so I've been pretty impressed, but good so far. Awesome. So what was the other part of the question? Sorry.
Oh, just in terms of, have you ever come close to winning the weekly in the past, or is this like just a bolt from the blue type thing?
I've been top 1%, if you want to count that as close, but I suppose it's good enough. I've been, I think, probably around the 1,000 to 500 range, but never really, first or, realistically in the mix. Nice. It's very good. I was just dead earlier. I was shocked. It's great to see.
Yeah, so obviously you had a big score on the weekend, but how are you traveling so far in 2022? And did you take any strategy into this season in terms of, I guess, your team structure?
Yeah, I did, Liam. I had normally the plan is to go, as most people would like to do, Gorn and Grundy. But this year, I've always been sticking tried and true to that. And this year, I thought, no, I'm going to try and go against that and try and spend my money elsewhere. And with the cheaper forward line options outside of, Taranto and Butters, and even Butters is a bit cheaper than the premium price, but at the start of the year it was. I thought, with Canelio and Gresham, they were the two I wanted to get. So I thought, try and keep the cheaper players in, then I could bulk up that midfield. And now, since the start of the year, I brought in, I had Jack still at the start of the year and brought him out once he had that big break, even on 205 or something like that. Likewise with what Max Gorn had. So I started with Gorn and Rowan Marshall. Now I've taken Gorn out, and probably 2 weeks ago I brought in Tim English, and he scored 200s over that period. So that's my main strategy was to go away from that Gorn Grundy and try and spend that money elsewhere. And there was a lot of good premium defenders, not so many good rookie defenders to pick from. I was kind of stuck to go with McCartan and Sam De Koning and Nathan O'Driscoll. Even though he didn't play round one, but O'Driscoll, that is. But now with those three, seem to be trailing okay, providing no one gets injured there.
Yeah, definitely. As you mentioned, you've been playing for about that 10 years. Any learnings, that you've adopted over that time that you've brought into this season of SuperCoach?
Yeah, so never to stock up on more than 4-5 max of players from the one club. Now, probably when I started, some people may be surprised. I didn't always choose St Kilda players in bulk amount, but for any side, even this year, I started doing my team. I had at one point 6 or 7, I kid you not, in the preseason Collingwood players. And I'm like, shit, I can't have that many. So I'm going to have to, tone it down. Then I go, all right, I'll take out this Collingwood player and I'll go see who else. They go, oh, yeah, I'll get this player. Oh, damn, it's another Collingwood player I've picked in between. So I had Dacos and Pat Lipinski, who's probably my secret weapon, I suppose, pre-season. When I had done my own so-called team reveals, I didn't fully reveal the team. There was 2 players I was hiding from telling people I was picking, and Pat Lipinski was one of those 2, and he's done pretty well consistently. I think he's averaging 94. So, the trend is basically not to pick more than 4 players from the one club.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. Yeah, it's one of those things you kind of live and learn. I've been playing since, like yourself, since high school as well, but I finished high school back in 2005. So I've been playing for most of my life. So probably a quarter of my life, probably a third. Yeah, but just in terms of, I guess you kind of touched on there, I was going to say, surprising. When I heard that you'd miraculously won the weekly prize, I had a look at your team and I was thinking, surely he hasn't picked a complete lineup full of St Kilda players, which was a surprise because I know how much you love your Saints. And you touched on there in terms of some of those trades that you made, you know, you brought in English at the expense of Gorn, that sort of thing. Were there any other, I guess, major moves that you made outside of that? And I wanted to touch on as well, I noticed that you've got Sinclair on your team. He is a Sainter, of course, but when did you trade him in? And I guess, when did you trade him in, if you did, or did you start with him?
I actually just brought in Sinclair for the round just gone. So thanks to Sink for popping up for another big score for me and providing it. But one interesting move I did have, that probably won me the SuperCoach, which you might find intriguing, was Jack Hayes. Now, I always had Jack Hayes and Nick Martin from Essendon from the start. And I had that loophole with Ned Long from Hawthorn. I see some people going, oh, why would Jim Ned Long on the ground? He's fluked it. Well, no, that was a clear strategy. If people know what a loophole is, and you check the teams, you check if the player's going to be on the emergency list, and Ned Long wasn't in the extended squad for Hawthorn when they announced that on Thursday. So I knew full then I could use that loophole of him. Had a look, obviously, when the Saints and Essendon were playing, St Kilda were playing first. So I put, clearly, as you guys would know, that put the emergency on Hayes. If he goes well, I'll take his score. If he doesn't go well, then there's Nick Martin there who's performing well as well. So, yeah, that was my that was probably the move that won me the round. Had I not gone with Jack Hayes to score, and I would have lost by 2 points to whoever was second. So, yeah, so thank God for Jack Hayes. And thankfully, St Kilda played first, because if Nick Martin played first and scored what he scored this round in 71, I actually would have taken that. So therefore, if I did, I would have lost by the 2 points. So, yeah, I suppose you can thank Trevor Zolder, the fixturing, and getting a good score to take his score. Otherwise, this wouldn't have happened.
It sounds like you owe a few beers to a couple of St Kilda players there, and to good old Trev there for the fixturing.
That's right. There were people complain about the fixture, but for this one, I'll take it.
Fair enough. Are there any, I guess, primos as well that you're looking to target in the next, you know, week or two, or just first up, I guess?
Yeah, well, just recently, I haven't done any trades officially so far while we're recording this for this round, and I may not do so. But more on the cheaper premium side is Tom Green as well. Obviously performed really well. He's always racking up over 30. I brought him in only a few weeks ago as well. So, and Paddy Cripps, people had earlier in the year. I didn't start with him. I did bring him in actually the week before he got injured. So I only kept him for a round or two. And he obviously may be back this week, maybe. But I wasn't risking to keep him. There was that little thought of keeping him on the bench. But I thought, no, well, this weekly prize wouldn't have happened had I benched him and just used a rookie. Connor McDonald would have been the one I would have used. So luckily I didn't go that way. So but for the premium, so yeah, Jack McRae is always a lock. And he gets over 30 every week. It's a no-brainer. I know I said I just traded Jack Steele back in after having him at the start. He's someone that, had he not had that high break, even I would have kept in, because he's obviously ultra reliable. Clayton Oliver, another one to keep in. Daniel Rich, who I started the last few years with, I started him this year and then took him out for Jack Sinclair. The round just gone. So that move worked out well. Again, had a high break even. James Sicily, I mean, cheaper premium at 440 odd. It was a no-brainer as well to bring in Sicily, who's obviously very good with his ball use and always gets over 20 every week.
Yeah, nice one. And I guess as a super coacher for a long period, you'd have those players that you like to avoid as well in super coach. And I know I've got a few. Who are they? Who do you know, sort of automatic non-selections?
I reckon we share a few.
I had a brain fart. I can't remember, but there is position-wise, but do not target key position defenders. That's just pretty stupid to get key defense outside maybe the rare few, like maybe Stephen May this year. But, players like he's a very good player. Just one off the top of my head, Alex Pierce. Like, he's a great defender. I know he's injury prone as well, but players like that, they may be good in their role, but they're not super coach player roles. So you don't touch them. I mean, key forwards, probably outside of key forwards, outside of Tom Hawkins, maybe not even him. Key forwards I wouldn't touch either, because players like, I was talking to one of my mates, he had who's not very experienced at all, is having to go for his first year, Jeremy Cameron in his team. Like, mate, I know you go for Geelong, and I know he's a good forward, but you can't have Jeremy Cameron, because if he's not, even when he's kicking four goals, like there's a couple of times this year, he still hasn't cracked 100. So, you know, you got to avoid key position players in either end of the field.
And it sounds like you've done it well as well, like in terms of separating your heart from your head. Like, you know, I was joking before about, you know, expecting to see you have a team full of St Kilda players, but it's the same sort of thing. You've got to use your head, and even though you'd love to have, you know, as many other St Kilda players in your team, you know, because you love watching them, and you get extra enjoyment out of watching them for a super coach, from a super coach perspective as well. But you've kind of got to separate the two, don't you?
You can't have many people playing the same team, no matter what the club is, and especially your own too, and make it look even worse.
Yeah, for sure. There's one player that I thought you may have mentioned, and it's one that Liam and I sort of half joke about, but sort of half serious as well, because he always burns us when we own him, and he burnt us a couple of years ago when we did own him early on, and then he came good after we traded him, and it is Bont, Marcus Bontempelli.
Yeah.
I know some people love him, other people hate him. Is it one of those things where, you know, are you... You know, because he's a unique sort of player. He can play up forward, can play in the midfield, roam around the ground. But, yeah, he's just one of those guys that's just burnt us in the past. And he's probably a burn man, and he's on my not never again list, but he's a marked man.
Honestly, I haven't really considered him, mainly for a few reasons, not for the reasons people may expect. It's probably more so for his price. And I know he pulls some scores over 100 that, you look at the stats compared to other people having similar stats where he's scoring, somehow getting an odd 150, but plays with similar, you know, disposal efficiency and score involvements and everything like that, clearances. They might be having 10 possessions more than him and better efficiency, and yet they're scoring less. Mm. The player's scoring better with the stats compared to him. But, his main reason I don't have him and I haven't really considered him is his price. And, I mean, when I got McRae, or when I started with McRae, Steele and Oliver, and Andy Brayshaw, who's highly underrated, does who? I mean, you can't have five mids at over 580 odd. So, I mean, he's kind of one that's been left out. And if his price does drop to around, if it does, drop to around 500,000, 480 odd, then, I mean, you'd have to shortly consider him at that stage. I did actually now, just thinking about it, a player that I would never touch again, and I haven't touched him for a few years, and I never will again. I don't care if he's 400,000. Is Michael Walters never, ever going to grab Michael Walters?
Yeah.
Never.
Yeah.
Very good. I think, Liam, did you trade him in 1 year?
Yeah, I had him 2 years ago, 3 years ago, maybe.
Yeah.
I remember. I'm the same. I actually, that brought up a lot of memories. Oh, yes. A lot of bad memories.
No, never touch. Unless, even if it's for maybe one game in the last round when you, or something like that, if you need a premium player at an average price and you've got, say, one trade left, it has to be someone at his price range, I'd probably then maybe take it. That's the only time I'll consider him. But when you've got the game in the line, no chance.
No, smart. Yeah. Smart. To finish off the chat, Coops, were there any words of wisdom you can impart on our listeners and viewers heading into round six and beyond?
Yeah, don't burn all your trades straight away. Last year, I did say about my ranking was probably my worst year. Again, trying different strategies and did not use them all early. I had a point last year. I think it was around four rounds to go. It was the round that Scott Pendlebury got injured. I don't know what round that was. I think it was his hand or finger or something. He missed the rest of the season. That round, I actually brought him in, and that was my last trade. And then to bring him in for my last trade, with about four rounds to go, and then get injured, and then I couldn't had no bench that following week. So three of the last four rounds, I think I had no cover for him on the bench because they all weren't playing either. And and it burned me. That's probably what got me to around the top 20% of last year. So yeah, don't burn all your trades so early and use them wisely. I've used seven so far, which is probably a lot, but use your boost trades wisely too. You probably ideally want to have three boost round trades around the mid-season near the buy rounds. Otherwise, you might be in trouble there.
Have you used any or many of the boosts so far?
Yeah, so I've used seven trades and two of those have been with the three boosts. So, probably not ideal. I'm planning to touch a boost until one of the buy rounds. So, and then we'll go from there and assess from there. But it is interesting, though, if I do hang around the top 1%, around the top 200 range, I'd have to think even harder if I want to stay in that range to balance whether I do use them or not, but probably don't want to touch them. So, yeah, don't waste your trades early, otherwise you're screwed in the back half.
Yep. Yeah, sounds very similar. We had last year's reigning champ, SuperCoach Mummer on, M. Chalice, and she was sort of imparting the same words of wisdom as well. So it's you've got to kind of remember, don't you, it's not a sprint, it's a marathon, and the season goes for 22 weeks or 23 weeks.
Yeah.
And, you know, you don't want to be burning your trades up until the last month of the season where you find players getting rested, players getting injured, all that sort of stuff. So especially if you want to be, if you're around the mark, which you are now, Coops, like, you know, you are, you want to be sticking around that mark.
Yeah.
Yep. And sort of guessing what other I guess super coaches are doing and hoping, fingers crossed, that they're burning through trades and you're conserving them, and then you can just speed home for the to the finish line. Awesome, as mate. Well, thank you so much for giving us your time, mate. Yeah, you've been awesome, and I reckon off the back of that, we can probably call ourselves the three wise men. I reckon. Hopefully,
that's right. I'll take that, Damo and Liam. Thanks for having me on, guys, and good luck with your page. And I'll put a plug up for you guys soon. So thanks for that.
Oh, thank you so much, mate. It's been ripper chatting to you, and you know, be keen to get you to jump on sometime in the future if you're equally as keen.
Absolutely, sounds good, guys. Cheers.
Awesome. And with that as well, don't forget to check out Kick It to Scoops on YouTube, and of course, check out his Facebook page as well, which is AFL information, trade rumors, and results. And we'll speak soon.
Cheers, awesome.
Thanks, mate.
Thanks, Coops.
Cheers.
Yes, that was Cooper Grech, and thank you so much for joining us, Cooper. You've absolutely nailed, I guess, the weekend in itself as a whole. Absolutely nailed it. So well done, mate, and great to have you on. But let's quickly just have a bit of a peek at the group rankings and SuperCoach Edge Cash League. So in terms of the group rankings, the highest scorer for round five was Peter with the Booze Hounds with a score of 2,365. And the overall highest scorer is Jivan with Jev's Jets with a total score of 11,664 and an overall rank of 159. So well done there, Jev's Jets. But if you want to enter the SuperCoach Edge group, of which you can join at any time, the code is 142059.
Yes, and just quickly updating on our SuperCoach Edge Crown League for Tier 3 Patreon subscribers. The winners from this round were Damon with his team D, DJ Trade-A-Lot, Jacqueline with her team Mid-Price Madness, Peter with his team Tankman 77, Kyle with his team Northwind, and Matthew with Team Orion. And we'll just quickly run through the ladder, as I think we mentioned we would do last round.
Whilst you're looking at that, Liam, I'm just going to quickly mention Peter, who is my future father-in-law of Tankman 77. He actually, because we had Good Friday dinner at your place with your family. It was very, very kind of you to invite us all over. And you might have noticed Peter and myself having a bit of a chat. We got in trouble, actually, for talking too much SuperCoach. And it was because Pete, and he's probably listening to this or watching it on YouTube, he was having a bit of a chat to me slyly and was like, oh, I'm actually playing Liam this round. I don't think he knows. And he was looking at your team and he was like, oh, I think, you know, do you think I'm a good chance of beating him and stuff? What trades do you reckon he's doing? So he would be absolutely stoked. I haven't spoken to him since the round finished, but he would be stoked that he's beaten you.
I know.
Classic.
Was a good match, I will say.
Very good.
But unfortunate. Nice to you, Liam. Yeah. Got to do these things sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
But anyway, let's have a quick look at the ladder. On top of the ladder, we've got Kyle with his team Northwind. Damon, you're in second spot.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Love it. You took my spot. I was in second spot last round.
You just warmed my seat. Thank you, Liam. How kind of you.
I'm coming back. But anyway, in third spot, we've got Brett with his team, the Sharpshooters. In fourth spot, it's myself with Church of Parish. Peter, if his win against me on the weekend, finds himself in fifth spot with his team, Tankman 77. Jacqueline is in mid-price, with her team, Mid-Price Madness, is in sixth. Black on White with from Arthur is seventh. Eighth spot is Matthew with his team Orion. Ninth, Bruce with his team Shuin. And Lyle Styles in 10th spot. So, you know, but Lyle is on the board. He has, there's no one's Owen in this league, which is nice to see.
The only Owen is the bloke that's on Scoops' bench who plays for St Kilda. He's the only Owen that we know of.
Exactly.
But that brings us to the end of the show. But before we go, let's just have a bit of a recap of all of our social channels. And before I throw to you, Liam, to do that, don't forget to jump on our Discord. Of course, we've opened the doors. We've flung the doors open to our Discord chat, our community. So make sure if you are on Discord and if you aren't, join up and join our Discord, because it's a thriving community that we want to grow and thrive even more. So in order to do that, check out on, I guess, Facebook, Twitter. I'll be putting up a post as well about that. Click the link, go through, join up, join in the conversation, bit of banter, bit of fun, bit of laughter. So check it out. But Liam, what about our social channels?
Yes, if you want to find us on YouTube to, watch this podcast as in its video format, you can search SuperCoach Edge, and don't forget to like and subscribe. On Twitter, you'll find us at SuperCoach_Edge, Damon at DamoJ88, myself at LiamEvans_95. On Facebook and on Instagram, you'll also find us at SuperCoach Edge.
Yes, well, that's a wrap. And with that, I'm about to jump back into bed, I think, because I'm absolutely cooked. I don't know how I've lasted this hour-long episode, but there was a time there where I needed to be benched. I was running out of gas. He was on standby, wasn't he?
Franco was doing laps of the hallway getting ready to
I could hear him like knocking on the door, like rapping on the door, scratching like a cat, like, let me in. But yeah, my right eye was tearing and I had to blow my nose and stuff. So apologies to those of you listening and watching out there to watch me battle through this COVID battle in itself. But hopefully I kick its ass and I'll be back fit and firing for next week and you won't hear this congested voice of mine. But thanks again, Liam, for joining me. And thank you to the listeners and the viewers. And we'll catch you next week.
Yep, and I hope you're feeling better next week, Damon.
Thank you.